Jaya Kundabi Adi. Jaya Radha Madhava. Jaya Kundabi Adi. Jaya Gopi Janavanabha. Jaya Giri Varadadi. Jaya Girivada Dadi. Jaya Gopi Janavanabha. Jaya Giri Varadadi. Jaya Giri Varadadi. Gopi Janavanabha. Jaya Yesudanandanu. Jaya Braja Janaranjana. Jaya Braja Janaranjana. Yesudanandanu. Jaya Braja Janaranjana. Jaya Yesudanandanu. Jaya Braja Janaranjanu. Jaya Braja Janaranjanu. Jaya Jyamuna Tira Vanachari. Jaya Kundabi Adi. Jyamuna Tira Vanachari. Jaya Jyamuna Tira Vanachari. Jaya Kundabi Adi. Jaya Jyamuna. Jaya Radha Madhava. Jaya Kundabi Adi. Jaya Radha Madhava. Jaya Kundabi Adi. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare,
Krishna, Hare Krishna. Krishna, Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama. Jaya Prabhupada, 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 Jaya Prabhupada, Jaya Prabhupada, Prabhupada, Prabhupada. Jaya Prabhupada, 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 Jaya Prabhupada, Jaya Prabhupada, Prabhupada. Gaura Premanandi, Hari Hari Bo. Jaya Vishnupad Paramahamsa, Prabhupada, Sri Divine Grace, Srila Asi Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada Gitaji. Jaya Vishnupad Paramahamsa Vivrantacharya Sattvine Grace Bhakti Sananda Sarasvati Thakur Kitai Anantakuri Vaishmani Kitai Grantharaj Srimabhautam Kitai Nita Gaura Premanandi Hari Hari Bo. All glorious and lotis, all glorious and lotis, all glorious and lotis, all glorious Shri Gunshi Gauranga, all glorious Shri Prabhupada. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayana Namaskritya. Naram Chavanarotamam Devam Sarasatim Vyasam Tutu Jayamudirayat. Reading from the Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 10, Chapter 16, Text 16. Tamstata kataram viksha Bhagavan Madhavo Balaha
Prahasya kinchinovacha. Prabhavagyo nijuja. Prabhavagno nujasya saha. Tamsita kataram viksha. Bhagavan Madhavo Bala. Prahasya kinchid novacha. Prabhavagno nujasya saha. Tamstata kataram viksha. Bhagavan Madhavo Balaha. Prahasya kinchin novacha. Prabhavagno nujasya saha. Tamsata kataram viksha. Bhagavan Madhavo Bala. Tamsata kataram viksha. Bhagavan Madhavo Bala. Prahasya kinchin novacha. Prabhavagno nujasya saha. Viksha. Nandayo bala. Prahasya kinchino vacha. Nujasya saha. Ladies. Tamsata kataran viksha. Bhagavan Madhavo Bala. Prahasya kinchino vacha. Nujasya saha. Tathagataya viksha.
Tan them. Tata in such a condition. Kataran distressed. Viksha seen. Bhagavan the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Madhavaha the master of all mystic knowledge. Bala, Lord Balaram, Prahasya, gently smiling, Kinchid, anything at all, Na, did not, Uvacha, say, Prabhavagna, knowing the prayer, knowing the power, Anujasya, of his younger brother, Saha, he. Translation and purport. The Supreme Lord, Balaram, the master of all transcendental knowledge, smiled and said nothing when he saw the residents of Vrindavan in such distress, since he understood the extraordinary power of his younger brother. Please repeat. The Supreme Lord Balaram,
Supreme Lord Balaram,
the master of all mystic knowledge, smiled and said nothing when he saw the residents of Vrindavan in such distress, since he understood the extraordinary power of his younger brother.
Purport. Sri Balaram is a plenary expansion of Lord Krishna and is thus non-different from him. They are in fact the same absolute truth, manifest in separate forms. According to Srila Vishvanatha Chakravarti Thakur, Lord Balaram was laughing because he thought, Krishna never cares to play with me in my form of Sheshanag. But he is playing with this ordinary mundane snake named Kaliya. The question may arise as to why Krishna and Balaram allow their loving devotees to suffer such great anguish during Krishna's temporary imprisonment within the coils of Kaliya. It must be remembered that because the inhabitants of Vrindavan are completely liberated souls, they did not experience material emotions. When they saw their beloved Krishna in apparent danger, their love for him intensified to the highest degree. And thus, they merged completely into the ecstasy of love for him. The whole situation has to be seen from the spiritual point of view, or it will not be seen at all. Translation once again. The Supreme Lord Balaram, the master of all transcendental knowledge, smiled and said nothing when he saw the residents of Vrindavan in such distress, since he understood the extraordinary power of his younger brother. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Janandana Shalakaya Chakshuram Maditam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Svapatantikam Vanchakalpadrubhyascha Kripasandubhye Pacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavibhinamo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Srivasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare Vakam Karoti Vacharam Pangum Langai Te Girim Yakripatamaham Vande Shri Gurum Dinataranam Shri Paramadamadamam Shri Chaitanya Yashvaram The pastimes of the Bhagavatam have quite a unique, exciting aspect, which we always have to see in terms of a vision of how we can apply it in our life. It's not that we just place the Bhagavatam on a pedestal, and in that way, oh, this doesn't apply to me. But actually, when we learn about how the Lord will perform his various leelas in so many extraordinary ways, and here, we're reading about how the residents of Braj are being placed in such anxiety. Here, Lord Krishna has gone into the waters of Jamuna to play. Of course, the residents of Vrindavan were not thinking. He's just playing with him, playing with Kaliya the snake. So many toxins, so much danger is there. But the Lord is simply relishing. Ah, what a way to draw attention from my devotees. Krishna says, as it's described, Yasyanam Nuganami, Hadusye Tanam Shanai, to show special mercy, I take things away. I mean, you're thinking, well, these are the residents of Braj, Vrindavan, beautiful forest trees and plants, animals, and there's Krishna, and beautiful cows and cowherd boys. Oh, and they're wonderful, very attractive gopis. Things are all, like, wonderful, very, very beautiful. But no, 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 Krishna, he likes to take away all security. Actually, it's described in the Golok Vrindavan. Of course, we're reading from the Bhom Leelas, the pastimes of the Lord, where there's actual demons. In the Bhom Leelas, there's actual demons that are there. But in Golok Dham, There's only rumors. See, Krishna doesn't let him alone. You go back all the way, and you're in the spiritual world, and you have a body which is Satchit Ananda Vigraha. Krishna doesn't let up. Ha ha! There's rumors of demons now. What? Demons? What? Are Krishna? Ha! You see here, the residents of Braj are being absorbed in complete ecstasy. In the fear they lose Krishna. So here, Krishna employs the actual demons, and Balaram's kind of like laughing. Here I'm Seshanag is my expansion, and Krishna won't play with me, you know, in terms of my form of Seshanag. But here's a mundane snake, Kaliya, that he'll automatically play with. So how do we understand this intensity? Because by the mercy of Srila Prabhupada, we have been given an alternative future. Because here, we've been born in the land of so many demons. Small demons compared to what we see in the Bhagavatam, but demons nonetheless. Prabhupada said the face is the index of the mind. So you can see a personality by just their physical expressions. I remember I was distributing books in Adelaide, Australia, and I met one man coming down the street. And I've never, of course, I don't want to imitate it, but I've never seen anybody with such a grueling, disappointed, materialistic face. I mean, I don't feel uncomfortable doing it, but it's like really, you know, like everything was like, you know, like a mask. Book distribution is an art where you want to place yourself in the shoes of the people you speak to. So you kind of look like them, you know? I mean, kind of like you walk like a little old lady, you know? Of course, everyone has their own perfection, but this is the art of distribution that you develop a common relationship, then they kind of feel comfortable, then they're willing to do whatever you want. So our goal is to present deities. But anyways, I remember when I saw this man, and he was so materially engrossed, so like this. And then I tried to imitate it, and I won't do it here in Bhagavatam class because it'll throw me off from my proper conscious effort here. But I was feeling so pained. Wow! That this is someone who's so forgetful of their self. He did take it. Actually, I forgot whether he took a Gita or not, but I should have stopped a lot of that. Anyways, but the point being is that it was a painful experience for the distributor to see the discomfort of the one who is in material field. So how do we understand our position? Or the gloriousness of our position? Because ultimately, you know, in the spiritual realm, Golok Dham, there are no conditioned souls. But there just so happens in the sandbox, the material world that we are in now, there are many conditioned souls. There's a very wonderful consolation that, well, ultimately, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakur said, we have to make the best use out of a bad bargain. Okay, so let us try and distribute knowledge, develop a sense of becoming part of a spiritual history. Dai, shishi, drunkenable silver ki dai, shishi goni dai ki dai, shishi lani shabar ki dai, and Giriraj Maharaj ki dai. You know, last time I didn't say Giriraj Maharaj ki dai. You know why? I didn't see him. It was just the angle. Maybe, I don't know, when I was on that side, I was looking maybe at the Goni Tai or something, but Jai Giriraj, forgive me for my offense in the previous class, but the beauty that we can appreciate is how is it that Krishna can do this situation, but also, hey, place us, we're devotees, we're following the principles of devotion, we're chanting the holy names, and we're trying to distribute to give you pleasure, but there's so much opposition. Hey, you, get a job. Go back to Mayapur, kid. Man, you know? So there may be so much opposition which is there, but ultimately Krishna has the greatest sense of humor. In the 10th canto, it's described your level of advancement is by how much you can tolerate. And you'll notice that actually when we are, shall we say, I remember, you know, I made this example when I was in Los Angeles, shipping in the airport, and I had great sadhana, and I was, you know, served right before Prabhupada, chanting every single morning and doing everything right, going to bed, rest at night, you know, everything was done. All of a sudden, it was great. But all of a sudden, I couldn't, you know, and I don't know, do you have many military men, RAF, is that, or the, who come through, and just like a bell go off, all right, you know, someone who's disciplined, military discipline, you know, you appreciate this, this talks about discipline, anyways, generally they're in a better consciousness, the Marines were very good in the U.S., so anyways, I couldn't stop anybody. I couldn't even stop a Marine, a cadet, you know, a little cadet, or even a Boy Scout that week. What happened? I was taking photos of the deities, and, you know, it's a long story, but one day, this Mataji, she'd always dress the deities with lots of heavy fruit. Vrindavan mood, but lots of fruit. Any pujaris sitting over here, you know? But a lot of big fruit, you know, and the crown's kind of hanging over, and it didn't really inspire me so much. But I would put pictures of the deities I took pictures of in the back room, and all the pujaris were very happy because they hadn't had new pictures in the back room for the last 10 years. How about Solo Street? Do you have recent pictures in the deity room of your beloved Takuji? Okay, next topic. No. But what happened was is that I didn't take pictures, and because I'd put this Vaishnavi in anxiety, then I became anxiety in my service. I'd committed an aparad. Unknowingly, I'd offended a Vaishnavi. And but she was in anxiety. She was crying one day, you know. Oh, Maharaj never puts pictures of the deities when I dress them. It has happened as Krishna Balaram's appearance day. Very soon she dressed the deities, actually very nicely, you know, so that I took a lot of good photos and put them back. And all of a sudden, I could see the books again. It's like, unknowingly, like was it when Hanuman jumped, and there was that demoness stepping on his shadow, and he was kind of like, what's going on? Something, you know, some impediment that's there. So how can we understand when there's intensity in the preaching field that this is a special blessing coming from Krishna? Even the book distribution or the temple management or to maintain a temple or to link different centers like our farm communities, maybe so much opposition or difficulty just doing that. Why does Krishna send these tests? And Krishna's always watching, and he's laughing. I think I said in your previous class, you know, Krishna, you come in to take darshan of the Lord, and the Lord's always smiling. And the Lord's smiling, you know, why is he smiling? He's smiling because of two reasons. One, he's smiling with you, you're smiling with the Lord because you're absorbed in service. You're happily distributing, you're happily doing your best, very good, last birth in this world. But if you're holding back, you're on Soho Street, or you go into Oxford Street, you know, and you start contemplating the ice cream in the windows, and wow, I saw the Brahmachari had a really nice, you know, really nice cell phone, man, that'd be cool. I could do all kinds of SMSs, and you know, but your mind becomes a Bahu, Shak, many branched. So then what happens is we lose focus in terms of giving Krishna pleasure. So what will Krishna do when you come to the temple? Krishna will smile at you. Come on, get it together. Come on, you know, I've given you so much. But ultimately, the Lord will always be smiling in all conditions. But basically, the Lord will never give us a test we cannot pass. So how can we come to the higher platform of realizing Krishna's tests as a perfect design, a perfect arrangement? Sadhu Sangha, Sadhu Sangha, Sarva Shastra Koi. Lava Mantra, Sadhu Sangha, Sarva Siddhi Hoi. That actually just a moment, Lava Mantra, a momentary association with a Mahatma, then we can get the vision. Of course, you're getting every day consistent association with Srila Prabhupada through his books, and you have those dependents of serving Srila Prabhupada, then there's more than just that Lava Mantra. It's this consistent Sadhu Sangha. And through that Sadhu Sangha, you develop a change of consciousness. You develop a change of heart. Like, you know, Mrigari the hunter, his whole design in life, his whole training is to kill animals? No. To half kill them. More nectar. Half killing, half pain. So he got the blessings of a sadhu, Narada Muni. And Narada, my dear sir, why are you doing this occupation? If you have to shoot an animal with an arrow, at least do it full. Don't do it half full. This is an offense. You see, Narada is a very expert preacher. Prabhupada focused on encouraging persons, not so much the don'ts, but the do's. Just half kill them. I mean, don't half kill them. Kill them all the way. And then the hunter was thinking, well, this is, but I have my training. And then Narada came to the preaching point. Don't kill them at all. Ahimsa, nonviolence, karma, goes around, comes around. And then he's thinking, but my training has been like this. My father has trained me how to hold a bow and to kill. It's all I know. So then Narada Muni preached the very wonderful point, so paramjusvanavartate, that you can experience a higher taste in life by giving up these lower activities. So then, in the association of Narada Muni, there was a change of consciousness to the point when Narada Muni went to visit him on a later occasion, he saw the same hunter that used to half kill animals jumping from side to side because he did not want to step on an ant. So here, this is the power, the purification of a sadhu. So in other words, how can we understand, how can we approach these essential needs to see Krishna's design perfectly? Of course, the residents of Vrindavan, they cannot be blamed. They love the Lord so much, and they were so absorbed in Krishna, so absorbed in all these pastimes. And it's amazing. I had the opportunity, I was in Varshana, and I happened to witness these little gopis, about the age of 8 to 11, and they were playing with these other two older gopis who were around 14 and 16. Those two ages like that. And the two older gopis were playing the role of Radha and Krishna. And the small gopis were actually climbing way up in the trees to get flowers because they're performing a lila. They're getting flowers for Radha and Krishna. They climb high in the trees. Little girls risking life and limb. And it was amazing to see. We read in the Bhagavatam, in the 10th canto, Krishna book, how the gopis are so absorbed in Krishna, always thinking about him. Even while, we remember when Radharani, the bee came. The bee and Krishna had left to Mathura. And then she's, oh, who is this bee? You're a spy. Get out of here, you know. You're a spy of that terrible lover of mine, like that. So in this way, then the bee went away, and then, oh, what have I done? The bee's going to give bad news to Krishna about what I said. Complete intoxication. So it's amazing seeing these girls. I mean, materially speaking, just two young girls are dressing up as Radha Krishna, and the other girls are getting some flowers. You know, like a play, you know. I mean, we have any actors here? You do a few plays, put a few costumes on. Ever done Hanuman with the club? I thought you made a good Hanuman. You know. So like that. We see an actor on the stage provides various, has various paraphernalia and accoutrements like that. So, you know, materially speaking, just some girls were dressing up as Radha Krishna, the other girls are getting flowers for it, but to see their absorption, to see how absorbed, trying to get, risking life and limb to get these flowers. And then, they were seated in a rasastali in Varshana, where every day the Lord dances in to apricot fashion. And so it's fun. I was there, I had my camera, you know, I had like one of those Canon digital cameras that did some movies to it. So then, because the two older girls speak a little English, so then I was just, oh, let's go, what do you got going here? Because, you know, we're a Sankirtan devotee, you know, nectar bear, trying to, so this is unique opportunity in the Dham. So then I went up, and I did an interview with Radha and Krishna. Radha and Krishna? So this is a Lilastan, and who are these persons here? They are our gopis. Oh, and they're getting these flowers for you. Yes, we like flowers. And then Krishna goes, you know, Morli, Menu, you know. And then one of the gopis ran off the forest and found a broken piece stick and gave it to Krishna. Now here's the simplicity. You didn't have to get like, you know, you might have like a real fancy little, you know, club or stick like that. Just when you got a basic stick right in the forest, gave it to Krishna. So I did an interview. So tell us, Radha and Krishna, about this place. Oh, this is Gabhavan. Gabhavan refers to where there's caves in the mountains. And we have many pastimes here, day and night. Here I am, I'm taking a photograph, and I'm taking video, and I'm going like, well, this is too much. Because you see, it's like in the Dham, the Brajvasis are like puppets to the Supreme, Radha and Krishna. They're puppets, they're extensions. You know, Prabhupada said, you never know who's sitting next to you. It could be, you know, Narada Muni. You know, in other words, you never know who you're around. My earlier class is making this point about humility and respect. Deal with each other nicely because you never know who's around you. So anyways, when you're in the holy Dham and your median personality is like this little. Now do the mathematics. They're Varshanavasis. They're born in Varshana. And there's Radha and Krishna there. And they're getting flowers. You never know what level of puppets they are in terms of, because you know these personalities are very dear to Krishna. As I said the other day in class, you just read the books your whole life. One day the hand they can reach out can be blue. So you never know who you're going to meet on Oxford Street, or to speak of who you're going to meet in. You can't distribute in the airport here, not like the other parts. Can you? No one does that. Okay. But or what to speak of when you go to India, Bharata Varsh, or you go to the Holy Dham, you never know who you're going to meet. So in this way, we're getting a bit of a vision of how we can be prepared to see Krishna's arrangements. Now, Bhagavatam says there's 10 essential ingredients which one needs to see Krishna's pastimes as they are. And the four principal ones, the first, you must have sadhu sangha. You must always have sadhu sangha. And the second one refers, you must always have the presence of devotional literatures. So good for our bhajan and our distribution. That is, it's a safety mark. And one must always be engaged in the activities of devotional service and also be engaged in the process of devotional service. Those are the four principal ones. And the Bhagavatam describes that if you have these under your belt, then you'll have a particular vision of understanding of what I can offer Krishna, what we can give him. It's described in the Gita that one should offer me, you know, one should offer everything to me. Whatever you do, whatever you sit, whatever activities you perform, do it as an offering to me in love. And then Krishna says, then dadami buddhiyogam tam, I will give you intelligence by which you can come to me. So we have to understand in our field, driving a particular yantrarunanimaya, a machine made of material energy, and we have to deal with so many situations, how can we also understand Krishna's arrangements are perfect and complete. You see, even the residents are so absorbed in Krishna, they did not have the awareness of Balaram in terms of seeing Krishna as playing with a snake. They were thinking, this is our Lord. He's gonna drown. And Nanda Baba goes into the Jamuna himself and begins to cough at all the fumes and then Balaram has to pull him back. See what intensity. There's such danger. So in the same way, we can develop a wonderful vision of how to, at least in this field, though we don't have that type of loyalism or greed for Krishna, to at least understand the difficulties as a process of purification. Now, the principle, the problem is that we begin to forget to see Krishna. Ishvara Paramakrishna, Sachit Ananda Vigra, Anadir Adir Govinda, Sarvakarna Karanam. And Krishna, he is a supreme controller. He is the cause of all causes. He is the originator. We forget that vision. So then we begin to think in terms of this sandbox mentality. I'll. We forget the vision of wheel. So in this way, we get caught up. For one who is in the modes of material nature, there's in terms of the process of, as we study the material nature in the field, it can affect the consciousness. It can make us, in terms of, as described, Sat Chit Ananda Vigraha. This is eternality in relationship to the Lord. But ultimately, we become attached to Asat, things which are temporary. They have no real nature. That's what happens when we don't have this knowledge, when we don't have this vision. And then in Achit, we go after things which knowledge which has no eternal value, plastic. Just like I was as a traveling, I came coming through Oxford University. Any graduates here from Oxford? No, okay, I'll be light. No, but I was distributing there, and I was noting, because I spent a lot of time in areas like Harvard and Yale, and we visited spent time in those areas in the U.S. So it's interesting. It's our first time to Oxford because it's probably the most prestigious and oldest university on the planet, most recognized like that. And so I was, first of all, when I went in there and you see all the sculptures, they have like the museum part, and they have these guys with the caterpillar holes in the eyes or something, there's so much erudition there. And one of the main, beautiful statue, one of the leading founding fathers. Forgive me if I make any offense here, but five pigeons that were saying shoulder passing stool. But but I was catching a mood. It has an atmosphere, a great intensity there. Very, very beautiful building. See, I went to a preparatory school, prep school, as you may say. I don't know what you call them in this country, but preparatory school for the places like Oxford. And very heavy competition, heavy dress code, coat and tie. Of course, I guess that's pretty much standard in the modern public schools. There's not so much coat and tie. In India, everyone wears coat and tie, going to school. But it brought me back to remembrances of the past, of going for knowledge. We're not trying to make fun of our working class in the room today, but it was amazing. Just the persons I was meeting, yes, very, very, like I think it was Niket. Niket? He had been given some kind of a ticket by some friend to go to an Oxford meal. Like, I hope he's not watching, but there was a big dinner where all after the college, graduates would come together, and they would all sit down at a big, big table. So one person who was supposed to go gave Niket this tag, because I guess he wanted to, it's like in Krishna consciousness, you can get all your material desires out of your system if you want. So he wanted to hang with the big wigs, So he's sitting there at the table, and the professors of, iridology there, and history, and mathematics, and economics like this. And so they're sitting there at the table, and there's Niket there, kind of looking around, Everyone knows Niket, like this. And so, sir, what was your graduate of, emphasis, like that. And he goes, I said, economics. Oh, very topical subject, yes, And it was, I think someone knew he was there, Yes, he knows a lot about economics. You ask him any question you want. Oh, very good. About the modern market, sir, So he had to get some quick answers. He got a good brain, but he had to get some quick answers, kind of like, to show that he was a graduate of Oxford. But the point being is that I was kind of, I was just kind of relishing to see the different attitudes, because you have to take a similar stance in order to develop some common denominator. And so this is the nature, especially when we have to deal in arenas where there are the three modes of material nature. Because if we're not fixed in spiritual knowledge, we cannot see Krishna's design, we cannot see Krishna's arrangement. So then, the different modes of material nature, rajas, tamas, sattvas, that ultimately, it's like when you go to a stoplight, you have different lights that are there. And you have the green, which can be seen as a mode of goodness, Or you can have yellow in terms of tamagun, mode of ignorance, and then rajagun, the red. And each, as described in the Gita, there's always a competition for supremacy with these lighting systems or the modes of nature. But when there's a mode of ignorance, or there's a mode, a prominent mode of passion, then the whole conscious adjusts. Even like, you know, in terms of the most famous material activity, as far as sex pleasure in this world, as far as the details of the activity, if you look in terms of the modes of nature, that ultimately to be absorbed, shall we say, in that field, you have to have an animalistic consciousness. I mean, if you go to Vrindavan, you see the pigs. Where the pigs absorbed in? They're absorbed in so many mundane places. So in this way, it's interesting, the modes can actually change and the consciousness of a jiva. And as it's described, is that, you know, there's so much competition for supremacy that it limits our ability to see things as they are. Srila Prabhupada presented Bhagavad Gita as it is, not as it could be, as it was. There's 700 actually, different editions of the Bhagavad Gita. And ultimately, Prabhupada's presentation of as it is speaks about the emphasis of understanding the personal and impersonal feature, matter and spirit and the controller of both, surrender to Krishna. So in this way, we're being given a opportunity for purification. And the best way for us to remain, develop a sense of vision of how to become pure is ultimately through the chanting of the holy names. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Because we have to engage in a process of sadhana which can bring us to the topmost platform, to first help us develop that sense of love for Krishna as a residence of Braj, and at least allow us a helicopter vision. Like if you fly a kite, you can only see so much, but a helicopter has a great perspective. So even though we may not have full love for Krishna at this present point in time, as we follow the process of chanting the holy names, associating with saintly persons, and trying to give Krishna some capacity, the Nam Seva, Vaishnava Seva, Jiva Doi, that as long as we engage in this activity, then we'll be given we'll be pulled out from these modes of nature and develop an appreciation for where we can take real shelter. So ultimately, when we study, when we make forward steps, we'll be very conscientious to not become proud of our position. I'm a devotee for so many years. I've been coming to the Sunday feast for so long. I even know how to put a sari on before they told me. I remember when I first put a dhoti on, I did it the right way. It's like, wow, the bhakta leader's going, how'd you know that? I'm a bhakta. I'm Bhakta Bill. My last birth, I was devotee, I'm sure. But we don't want to become proud of externals. Because, you know, Narada Muni, he's a parishad, he's an eternal associate of the Lord, but also he's an empowered expansion. And there was that one time when Indra wanted to test. Because, you know, the demigods, they're always jealous. They're always jealous of the others. They, those jivas who are making spiritual progression. So anyways, he saw Narada Muni so expertly controlling his senses. Then he sent Cupid with apsaras to distract our perfect brahmachari. Oh. Anyways, what happened is that Narada Muni, by his tapasya, he burnt Cupid to ashes. Such tapasya. So anyways, that actually is another pastime. But he actually defeated the tests of Cupid. So then Narada became very famous in the heavenly planets. Oh, you're like a god. You're able to defeat Cupid. You're able to defeat the test of Indra. So Narada was kind of feeling, let me go check out Indra's abode. Because now it's like, ever walked into a room and, people are saying, I mean, if you ever walked in a room and someone's saying something nice about you, I want to ask if they said something bad. But it's kind of like the ears perk up. Oh, my goodness, that's so nice. They're saying something about me. So there's a nature of living in Andy like that, because Krishna's like that. We're the perverted reflection. Krishna loves to hear his glories, but he can get away with it. Yeah. He's a supreme lord, you know, doesn't go in the wrong place. But for us, oh, we hear our own glories. Oh, you know, then we become a little intoxicated. So in this way, Narada Muni was thinking, I made a big victory. Let me go get some glorification from the demigods, you know. And he even went there and he sat on Indra's seat. Oh, what's happening here? Can you imagine, you know? I won't go in, no, but, you know, it becomes so proud that you sit on Lord Indra. And demigods, you are a god, you know, you're actually such a god. You are doing so, you are empowered in this way. And, I'm just humble brahmachari, no worries. So then what happened is that it was Lord Shiva detected this pride, because he went to visit Lord Shiva next. You know, Narada Muni, he likes to go through the whole tour. So he went to visit Lord Shiva, and Lord Shiva says, you should not want respect for yourself. You should not want respect, because ultimately, especially from devotees, because this is just showing a sense of pride. But, you know, Narada, you know, of course, you have to understand in these pastimes that the Lord covers over his devotees for certain reasons, for our benefit. So Narada was thinking, well, you know, I've heard the philosophy, we're not the body, you know. Yeah, I know all this stuff. Lord Shiva, you know, chill out. Take it easy, you know. So then what happens, he approached Lord Vishnu. And Lord Vishnu, it's all around the universe now. Narada Muni's a bit puffed up today, you know. So Lord Vishnu goes, my dear Narada, you're such a kokbalu brahmachari, very good brahmachari, very pakka, such tapasya, such austerity, such sense control. But how have these inebrieties come upon you? Because how can you love me? And then Narada Muni snapped out. Oh, what happened? It's like the environments. You know, it's interesting. It's a nice story about how environments can affect our consciousness, because we're talking about the modes of nature. We're talking about how to see Krishna's plan. There's a blind son who's going with the parents. Like, especially in India, see how the children really take care of the parents. You know, in the Western culture, generally there's division. But there's a real unity. Anyways, they were blind parents, so they went to the forest one day, and the young kid was a young whippersnapper going, hey, what am I taking care of my mom and dad? They're blind. I'm a young puppy. Let me go out and experience the world. Let me go out and do things. Let me go out and experience. And so his mother was very intelligent, because he said to his mother, I want to go. I'm youthful. I got to go. Enough to take care of you guys. You can, you know, Christian, you know, the Supreme Lord can take care of you, you know? So the mother's very expert. She says, my dear child, okay, you can leave us, but one condition. Please help us out of this forest. She's very expert. Because what happened, as soon as he left the forest, that lovable son who had that change of consciousness, his mind snapped out of it. He goes, wow, my God. Why? How could I be thinking like that about my mother and father? And this is a story in the forest, Vedic culture, beautiful parts of Bharatavarsh, jungle, tigers like this. And there, even by going to a forest, there was a change of consciousness. Now, what to speak of living in the building blocks of material culture? What to speak of living in a big city, a modern city? There can be a polluted atmosphere. That is why you have to focus on a proper protection, proper sadhana. Then you're protected. In terms of the temple, Prabhupada said there are bases to fight Maya. By chanting the holy names, by practice, you will develop a sense of invincibility, because you're giving an inside scoop of what's happening. That beyond, we have to see everything in terms of energy. It's described in the Ramayana that actually knowledge and detachment both have a male feature. And the female aspect comes when we see there is devotion, bhakti, or maya is also the female aspect, a perverted reflection. So when you start seeing the subtleties of energies, then you can understand of how to avoid various pitfalls. So for example, when there is a chaste woman, an unchaste woman will not want to be in the same arena. So for example, for a devotee who is following the topmost chaste woman in terms of devotion, in terms of bhakti, maya will not enter. But as soon as we try and associate with that other woman, because what does a prostitute do? She basically, her orientation is for mundane attraction. And what happens is when that attraction develops, then maya sukaya baram avido vimudha, we become vimudha, super fools again, because we're associating with material energy. So when we see, okay, knowledge and detachment, they have a male feature, then the female feature of bhakti and maya. So as we take shelter of the process, take shelter of bhakti, maya will affect us less and less. Of course, maya has a thankless task, because ultimately, if her presence is not there, we're not meant to cry out, we're not meant to struggle. And I think I said in the earlier class that as you make advancement in Krishna service, there will be a day, even though you've gone through so many difficulties and so many tests, that you'll come to a plateau of realization where you don't lament the past. You don't lament what has happened to me 1 year ago, 1 week ago, 10 years ago, because that testing has brought you to where you are now. So in this way, we can relish how Krishna makes different arrangements to make us stronger. Now here we're studying a particular event of where Krishna, he's been in held by the Kaliya snake, and the residents of Braj are such anxiety, except with Balaram. There's such anxiety that Krishna is going to be, we're going to lose our Krishna. Now the residents of Braj are complete intense anxiety. Now one may ask, why is it the Lord allows his devotees to be anxiety? Or another question we can ask is, why does the Lord allow his garlands to wilt? Of course, we take them off before they wilt too long. But if you go to places like, why is there dilapidation? Why is there regression in arenas of Krishna's pastimes? You go to the Holy Dham and you will see. If you have material vision, you'll see in the Holy Dham there's so much plastic, there's so much pollution that's going on, and the sewers aren't properly made. Of course, now they're redoing all that in Vrindavan. Now the government finally understands it's a good tourist spot, so we might as well fix it up. But the point being is that finally, you know, there's pigs, and there's so many dirty things that are there. And it's true. It's described in the Shastra how Vrindavan Dham is deteriorating over in time. And Giriraj himself, Giriraj, we can't forget Giriraj, he's shrinking. He's going into the ground in separation. So what is this? And of course, Mayapur has got another scenario. Things are increasing. So then, how is it that Krishna allows his dham to deteriorate? How is it that he has allowed the hills to be broken by the mafia to make stone? Now that's stopped. How is it that hills, so much deteriorated, how is it that even if you go to many, many temples there, that there's so many pujaris who want money, 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 money. It's not Radha worship, it's Lakshmi worship. There's so much deterioration that's there, but why is it that Krishna allows this in his, because the Dham is non-different. His name, form, pastimes, activities are non-different from the Lord. So how is it happening? And the example is given how a mother scorpion, what does she do when she has her offspring? Because they're too young to go out and fend for themselves. What does a mother scorpion do? She allows them to feed off her own body, and then she dies. After that first meal, they're strong enough to go out and fend for themselves. That's the strange upbringing, but it shows you the nature of a mother scorpion. She gives her own life, her own body. Similarly, the Supreme Lord, he gives himself. He allows his own self, as far as his dham to deteriorate, or paraphernalia around him to deteriorate, to give us a choice in life. Whether we can go take shelter of the mayic aspect, seeing the female aspect of Maya, or take shelter of the spiritual aspect of bhakti, of devotion. Because when you see things in that light, then Krishna, he is making arrangements for us, like how the deity, the Archivigraha, comes to a field of forgetfulness to do what? To ultimately to give himself, give herself to others, and to bring others back home, back to Godhead. So Krishna is so merciful that he gives a part of himself. And we're the ones that have a choice of how to deal in various ways, how to deal the Lord's gifts, whether to surrender the process of devotional service, of bhakti, or to surrender unto the external energy. Now, again, I mentioned earlier that how are we getting access to this field? It all comes again to the chanting of holy names. And this is how we can come closer to understanding the residence of Braj. This is how we can come closer to the helicopter perspective of seeing things as they are. And ultimately then, when we read about how Balaram, he's kind of laughing, you know, at this whole situation because he knows what's going on. Of course, actually, in the Brahma Vimohana Lila, Krishna didn't give Balaram that prerogative, did he? He's like, what's going on? Balaram's looking, all the coward boys, they're being embraced so by the parents, and the cows are being licked like never before by the parents. Even Balaram was bewildered. You see the superiority of Krishna. He didn't understand that Krishna had taken the forms of the cows and calves. Krishna did not allow him to understand. Balaram's like, what's going on here? He finally had to ask Krishna, right? He could ask Krishna, and then Krishna said, well, by the way, these are all my expansions. Oh, that makes sense. But in this pastime, Balaram, he knew the cue. You know, he knew exactly what was happening. So in this way, we can understand that the real safety, the real position, the real understanding comes as we take shelter of the holy names of the Lord. This is how we develop a perfect vision. So I'm going to read a few verses of how to take shelter of the holy names, and you should note these verses down, because these verses, if you study these verses, what to speak of, live your life by these verses, you will not have any difficulty in your spiritual life. Actually, you'll develop such momentum in your spiritual life, you'll pull others with you. And these are some from our study that... if we look in the 12th canto, and last verse of Srimad Bhagavatam, 12:13-23, and this verse shows complete accuracy of how one can make advancement in Krishna service. So this is the culmination of the Srimad Bhagavatam. This verse is the Bhagavatam in a nutshell. Namah Sankirtanam Yasya Sarva Pana Pranashanam Pranamo Dukha Shamanas Tam Namami Harim Param. I offer my respectful obeisance on the Supreme Lord Hari, the congregational chanting of whose holy names destroys all sinful reactions, and the offering of obeisances unto whom relieves all material suffering. So it all comes down to the chanting of the holy names, which can hook us into the bhakti court and avoid the maya court. Now, in the 12th canto, the 12th chapter, previous chapter, text 46, Iti choktam dijasreshta yat prishtoham yashamava lilavatara karmani kirtitnainiha sarvanasha. Thus, O best of brahmanas, I've explained wherein you have inquired from me. This literature is glorified in full detail, the activities of the Lord's pastime incarnations. And the next text, 12:12-47. Patita skalidas charta kshutava vivasho grinan Harai nama ityachar muchanti sarva patakat. Even when falling, slipping, feeling pain, or sneezing, one involuntarily cries out in a loud voice, obeisances to Lord Hari, one will automatically be free from all his sinful reactions. Sneezing, falling, slipping, obeisances to Lord Hari, anything that comes your way, it's perfect and complete. Thank you for the design. Thank you for that person who said no. Thank you for that person who's donated. Thank you for this wonderful festival day. If we're thanking Krishna, I always tell four words that are often missing in our communication work is thank you, thank another devotee, thank you Prabhu for doing this seva, and be normal. Don't go to extremes, just be normal. So we have, you know, like we have, like you know, you're talking about, what's the Kanamha program, lounge, was it lounge? What was it? Mantra lounge. That's kind of cool, you know. Hey, you can have a lounge and a mantra at the same time. I like it, you know. So it's a modern way to present the medicine in an adjustable formula. So the point is that the pras, the holy name, can purify of all conditions, in all situations. You know, there's a nice, I'll read these. There's a nice pastime comes to mind in reference towards this verse. Okay, text 12:12:48. Sankirtana Bhagavan Mananta Shutan Bubhav Vyanasham Hipum San Pravishitam Vidyot Yashesham Yata Tamorko Brakam Ivati Rata. When people properly glorify the Supreme Personality of Godhead or simply hear about his power, the Lord personally enters their hearts and cleanses away every trace of misfortune. Just as the sun removes the darkness or as a powerful wind dries away the clouds. There's the book distribution in a nutshell right there. As you give, as you distribute, then creating good fortune for others, then the greatest fortune will come your way. 12:12:49. Haiva mangalam tadeva punyam bhagavan gunodayam. Words that do not describe the transcendental personality Godhead, but instead deal with the temporary matters, are simply false and useless. Only those words that manifest the transcendental qualities of the Supreme Lord are actually truthful, auspicious, and pious. And the last one, which is 12:12:50, tamyeva ramya ruchidam navam navam. Tadeva shashvan manaso mahotsavan tadeva shukkanava shoshanam drinam yad utamashako yasho no giyate. Those words describing the glories of the all-famous personality of Godhead are attractive, relishable, and ever fresh. Indeed, such words are a perpetual festival for the mind, and they dry up the ocean of misery. So these verses, again, 12:13:23 and 12:12:46-50 provide a contact capsule of the Srimad Bhagavatam of how to make a spiritual advancement and how to be in the best spiritual health in order to give knowledge to others. And what it all comes down to, the vision comes what's called aradhana, or worship. Devotional service is aradhana, worship of Radha and Krishna. And we see in one nice pastime, because I was speaking about this one verse, Patita Skalanas Charta, that even if you're sneezing, falling down, if you simply call out, obeisances to Lord Hari, then you make great spiritual progression. There's one nice story in the Ramayana about Meghanada. And he was a son of Ravana, a very powerful warrior, and he was performing great yajnas, worshipping Kali, Chandi, for different Shakti. And he's performing his great yajna. And Vibhishan, who was also the brother of Ravana, but he was favorable, he went to Lord Ram, if you do not kill him, not even you can stop him in this yajna. And in this way, Ravana So then Vivishan, he was like quite giving good advice. And when Meghanad was actually performing this sacrifice, the monkey soldiers, they went there. And they went to try and stop his yajna. And they were kicking him and biting him. And he was still sitting doing his mantras. And they couldn't help but honor his great power and his great strength. So in this way, the sacrifice was ruined. Why? The monkeys were throwing all kinds of stool from the trees everywhere. And so finally, because of the oppression of the monkeys, he had to finally get up. And he was fighting them off. And then he even took stool and threw it at Hanuman. And Hanuman became very, very angry. And he came back to hit him. But because he had the power of this Shakti, this Ma Shakti, that he could not be harmed. He could not be stopped. So then Sugriva and Hanuman, they went to safety by the side of Lord Ramachandra. But the point is that now the yajna had been broken, then Ramachandra could kill him. Of course, it is a lila. But the point being is that in the worship of a particular worship, there's great power that comes. So when Lord Ramachandra came to Meghanada before with his arrows, he was thinking, oh, where is Ram? Because he started pulling out the arrows. He didn't see Ramachandra. Where is Ram? Where is Lakshman? And as the arrows came and killed him, he was chanting the names, Ram, Lakshman. And in this way, he was glorifying by chanting the holy name of the Lord as Skalitas Charta. He, even while falling, by chanting the holy name, offering obeisances, he was freed from his condition. And Hanuman was thinking, what a great son. What a great mother. We should offer our respects to this mother because she's had such a wonderful son at the time of death. He's chanted the names of Lord Ramachandra. So in this way, the power of worship is the greatest power on earth, the greatest power in existence. And as we chant the holy names, as we take shelter of this great process, we'll make rapid advancement and see the Krishna plan, the Krishna test, the Krishna lila that comes before our eyes, whether it's in the material field or, to speak of, the spiritual field. If we're in the spiritual field, at least our attachment to Krishna will be 100%. But Krishna will allow us the helicopter experience as we become free from the modes of nature, as we take shelter of the holy name, and as we develop full faith in this process. So that's a few points we can learn from the verse today. So I'll stop here. Does anybody have any questions or comments at all about the subject? Yes. On our own strength, we can't do anything. On our own strength. Meaning, ultimately, you can't even comb your hair, if you have long enough hair, without the sanction of Super Soul. And by the arrangement of Antaryami, Super Soul, as one makes spiritual progression, it'll come in the form of the spiritual master, who is described as the outward manifestation of a Lord in the heart. So in other words, on our own strength, we have no power against the illusion, but it's our sangha, our association. So as we associate with spiritually minded persons, as we associate with reinforcements like the Guru Sadhu Shastra, then Dadami Buddhi Yogam Tam, the intelligence comes. So then what happens is our desire, that's the only thing we have is desire. And ultimately we have to desire for a sangha, we have to desire for strengthening association, then intelligence comes. But everything is coming from Krishna. Even though we make the right decision, even though you know the right thing to do, you always acknowledge it's coming from Krishna, that you're nothing, you can't do anything. But as soon as you acknowledge everything is coming by Krishna's mercy, then there's complete perfection. Then it's not I'll, it's wheel. wheel. You're never alone. You're always together. You're never alone in the prison of the material world. There's always a warden that'll help you. Okay, you be good, you get out. So in other words, yeah, it's just like an example of the prison. You know, the lawyer, the warden can give sanction, so-and-so can get out, or the prince can walk in and say, oh, what do you call when you give someone you just turn the books over, you know? Was that? Pardon, yeah, pardon. He's pardoned. So the prince, the king can do like that. So when the spiritual master comes into our life, he is like a viceroy on behalf of the Supreme Lord. He gives information which pardons our conditioned situation, and he gives us guidance of how to make advancement out. So in other words, it's never aisle. We can't do anything on our own strength. It's always wheel, Guru and Krishna. And then the Guru and Krishna sends association, and association absorbs you in the process, what I described earlier about the four main principles, the Sadhu Sangha in terms of association with literatures, association with devotional service, and activities of devotional service, those four, then you are making the right decisions, but it's always we. It's we, not me. It's we, always we. Yes? Yeah.
And Papa would enjoy then defeating that.
Right.
And you would also enjoy it.
Hmm.
The fact that you defeat your doubts.
Hmm.
But nowadays I find if you raise a doubt or you challenge something that Papa said, people then attack you instead of defeating your doubt.
Hmm.
You know, in other words, it's kind of a near fight reaction. Instead of defeating the doubt, you try to defeat the person who raised the doubt.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
And I stayed there for a whole week in college, and they put me through a lot of tests.
Mm.
And I thought, you know, I'll easily get through this. But what I realized was, it's not the knowledge that you get, it's the process of developing mental agility. They had very, very expert testing.
Mm.
It made you really have to use your brain
sure.
in a way that you don't normally do it.
Mm.
It's just like the military, it trains you to be disciplined.
Mm.
So when you go to a university like Oxford, they're very actually expert in training you how to really have to use your mind. And, and so I have this tendency to think that there's a danger in this whole surrender process, that you then just, you no longer use your own intellect sufficiently. You don't be yourself to a degree. There's a tendency to sort of make everyone into the same kind of sheep.
Mm.
So it's all okay, right? But the problem is that the outcome is not sufficiently good.
Mm.
It's just like we've got a great philosophy,
mm-hmm.
and we're all very nicely surrendered, and we all like that.
Mm.
But there's the deficiency in the outcome.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, when I joined, I was living in a self-sufficient farm. I was growing my own food. I had a horse and cart. I joined the movement. I had to get really fast, but I turned into a farm. This is all temporary.
Mm.
Eventually, I'm going to come back to really being an alternative society that Prabhupada actually wanted. So the thing is, that has not been overcome. So then you have to go back to really question things. But I find that there's too much of it. People are too afraid of really questioning things and bringing out the actual answers in this whole surrender process.
Mm.
And I don't even think that Krishna even likes that degree of surrender so much as he likes somebody who's a little bit awakened. Because Krishna himself, you know, just like if you're a king, you can have all kinds of yes men around you. They're not the people you really like.
Mm.
You really like somebody who brings out your, forces you to bring out your highest power. Just like a warrior, he likes another warrior who's a good fighter.
Mm.
That's why Krishna liked fighting with Hiranyakasipu. Kashipu or Hiranyaksha, because they were, you know, he created them as devotees, so they would be able to fight him. What I'm saying is the whole idea of that we, you know, we become like sheep to Shaitan, and people who are a little bit individual have sort of almost like gone out of the movement because there's no room for them. You can't fit into that kind of sheep-like mentality.
It's interesting what's helpful to understand from the beginning, which puts it all into perspective, is the design of the jiva in relationship to the Supreme Lord. That ultimately the original design is, as parts and parcels of Krishna, we're meant to be enjoyed. That's the design. We are meant to be enjoyed by the Supreme. That's his whole makeup. Krishna is the supreme enjoyer, and we are all meant to be enjoyed. All his principal expansions and the Leelas, as far as Radha's relationship, more reticent. It's all in terms of, because that's like the zenith, you know, in as far as loving relation. We have to be careful not to examine the zenith in terms of what bad experiences, which are warranted, we see in the material world, but the principle of enjoyed who's the enjoyer and who's meant to be enjoyed. So as living entity, Prabhupada describes clearly, we're all prakriti, we're all nature. So nature is always subservient towards the controller. So in that way, when we study the material field, okay, all the energy, and you're mentioning like, you know, a very prestigious institution, you know, in terms of the technique of educating the consciousness, that is so true. But the thing, what happens is that it doesn't matter what level of education, whether it's Harvard, Yale, or Brahma University, the highest level person, if we develop a sense of moving forward in terms of technique or knowledge without the enjoyer in the center, we got a problem. Lord Brahma had a problem because he began to think himself as a controller. So again, as I'm saying this, we're always going back to that principle of existence, of truth, of satyam, of reality. We are meant to be enjoyed. And Krishna is the original enjoyer. So okay, now we find ourselves in the material field where persons who have bad samskaras or who have bad habits, that they're trying to apply the process. And when you try and apply the process, it's like, you know, you can't condemn a dirty person who's in the shower. There's mistakes that are made. And like, you're hitting some very nice important points, which I've also gone over the years, is that one thing I've seen missing is a lack of accommodation. Because Radharani, to begin, she, again, going back to the focal point, she is the empress of accommodation. She is the personification of facilitating others, and that's why she is so dear to Krishna, because her love is so strong. She controls Krishna. So then it's even these relations she has of mom, where she becomes angry, not so reticent. It excites Krishna. Because what happens is that Krishna becomes so intrigued by how she operates, then he has to come as Mahaprabhu so he can understand. Krishna could not figure her out. Not even Krishna could. But by taking the incarnation of Lord Chaitanya, who came in the mood, of a recovered incarnation, then it gives access towards this essential principle of enjoyer and being enjoyed. So again, the educational is that there's nothing wrong with the education. It's how we use it. Are we using whatever our situation, our mind, body, and words, to be enjoyed by Prabhupada, to be enjoyed by Krishna? Now, if you look at the history, many persons have made mistakes. And you have, you know, many, many, many situations where persons have come and gone. And it can make us a little more reticent to think about when we look at this word of surrender. See, surrender doesn't mean blind faith, meaning without knowledge, without ras. Krishna says, rasavaya saha, I am the reservoir of ras. When there's surrender, when there's so-called following rules and regulations or doing this or doing that, without the loving exchange of ras, which comes from Krishna, it's originating from Krishna, then we fall into difficulty where we become, you know, Prabhupada says, the philosophy without religion becomes speculation. Religion without philosophy is fanaticism. That's the extreme sense of mechanicalism, our extreme sense of so-called surrender. That let me fight for the Führer. You know what I'm saying? It's like there's a type of surrender which is blind. But if surrender is based in loving exchanges, that, in other words, like you were mentioning how sometimes someone may ask a question of doubt or maybe question what Prabhupada said, you see, and then because the realization isn't able to answer the question, then you take out, you undermine the person who asked the question. So the point being is that when we always focus back to the original formula, the enjoyer enjoyed, and ultimately the most personification of these two principles of Radha Krishna, and those acharyas who come in parampara have this quality of accommodation. You look at what Srila Prabhupada has done, how he left India at such an elder age, and he went to the Bowery of New York City. He went to such a hellish place, but Krishna inspired him. But what did he do? And the first feast that were there, he would cook the feast, he would advertise for the feast, he would speak at the feast, he would serve out, and he would clean up. He did everything. Now talking about the personification of accommodation. So this is the mood we want to develop. Now, having said that, many persons who have followed Prabhupada's process have made mistakes, and they've come and gone. So many have come and gone. But the point being is that there's no loss, because those persons have devoted so much energy and service. They will pick up in a future situation their devotional career. And we want to be very conscientious that those who are here, to learn, as we look around one another, that actually each one of us are insurance policies for spiritual progression. Meaning, if I act in a mechanical way, or if a wooden-headed way, you know, becoming mechanical, or focusing surrender like a robot, then there's no loving exchange. I'm not seeing you as an insurance policy in terms of my relationship in parampara or approaching Radha Krishna. I begin to short sheet. You know the word short sheet? The kids would play jokes on their friends and they would take the sheet of a bed and put it up halfway and you can't get in like that. So that what happens, we limit ourselves from the process, we remove ourselves. And Prabhupada himself said, don't be surprised at those who go, be surprised at those who stay. Prasadam? Yeah, okay. So I'll answer one more sentence. We don't want anybody to go. So in this way, focus, it's true the negatives are there, but also you're being given a choice to exercise the positive. Okay, that negative's there, that maybe mechanical aspects and surrender, but let me look at the good. And if you are honest and you study the good that's there and surrender, then you'll be able to see a whole nother perspective. And then, guess what? I'm not saying you, I'm talking principally, okay? Then you don't become part of the problem. Because many persons can think very negatively, oh, yes, yes, the owl in the tree, it's dark, it's dark, it's dark, the sun, but Krishna Surya Sam, Mahan Andhakar. With the light of Krishna, darkness cannot enter. So the positive is there, and you become part of that positive formula, and then you'll see more things change, and guess what? You'll be the person to help initiate change. The power is in you, and that's the power given to us through Prabhupada, through Prabhupada, by the Lord. But again, coming back to who is enjoyed and who's the enjoyer helps these things fall into perspective. Hare Krishna. So, announcements? Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai. Sorry about that, I went over time. Okay. Okay. Bhaktapasya. 20 Lakshmi points, 3 small books, 2